I want positive input here, okay? You know, it's not what can we complain about tonight. That's over. We're going for the what can I share that's meaningful to discuss about, okay?
Can you tell us your name, please?
I'm Lena Ashley. I'm the design engineer for the project. So as I don't design bridges, I build highways, I work with our bridge designers. And I do want to answer your questions and give you information tonight. So we have 20 minutes, and I'm going to let Frank start, because what we're really focusing on is our environmental document. I'm going to help him, and I want at least half the amount of time to be questions. Is that okay, or do we want three quarters?
Why don't we say 20 minutes and extend it if we need to?
Because we want to allow other people to access us and have information, but I'm willing to be flexible.
One up at a time.
I think that's, yeah, let's go for 20 minutes, see how it goes. Let's aim for 10-minute presentation, 10-minute questions. Does that meet people's needs?
We'll see.
Okay, we'll see. Let's try it. We're going to start with you.
Okay.
And then I'll help. So hopefully we can achieve a satisfactory.
Well, hopefully everybody can hear me okay, and thanks for coming this evening. We plan to have this meeting with a broader community along the North Coast, and we didn't feel that the school up at Albion was probably large enough based on a lot of the staff that we were bringing with the displays. So I apologize if you thought for some reason we were not being more considerate of using the Albion school. But we wanted to actually bring our environmental consultant, ICF, who will be helping to prepare the draft environmental document and also the final environmental document for both the Albion River Bridge project and the Salmon Creek Bridge project. ICF will also be conducting the community impact assessment and the cumulative impact analysis for both projects. Now, there are a number of questions that I'm sure you all have about where we are in the process, and I think that this board right here will explain much of, you know, what your initial questions are, because we are still in the early stages conducting our environmental studies, and we are looking at a range of project alternatives that we've basically taken comments from the community, and we have developed a number of those alternatives that are available for you to review on the tables.
You know, do we want to go over the range of alternatives?
Yes.
Okay, so I want, hey Tom, will you talk about the range of alternatives for the Albion River Bridge? Tom Phillips is a project engineer for Albion, and Eric Lund's a project engineer for Salmon Creek, and he can talk about the range of alternatives.
I just want one question before you start.
Sure, Bill.
How many people here are not from Albion? Okay.
Are our law enforcement maybe not from Albion?
And why is law enforcement here?
We invited the whole community here. Welcome to attend also. But I don't, you know, other than interested like everyone else, I'm guessing.
We all use the bridge.
What are you getting at? What are you getting at, Bill?
I'm getting it. Obviously, this meeting should be held in Albion,
okay,
because,
you know,
but I'm not going to argue with you about it.
He asked
me. I don't want to get in the fight at all. But I do want to just
time for the commit. You know, the questions and answers.
That's
we agreed.
Fine.
We're not complaining about stuff anymore, right?
No.
We're all that. That's
no,
taboo.
We don't have to complain.
No more complaining. We're just going to give information and have questions. So thank you. If Tom will give us the range of alternatives for the Albion River Bridge in our EIR, and then Eric can for Sam, and I think that will help you understand what we're studying.
Perhaps.
That was an important question. Okay, so what are we studying, Tom, on Albion?
Albion will break down. There are three alignment alternatives. There are three alignment alternatives for Albion. There is a west and clear of the existing structure, which means that you can have traffic on the existing structure while that one's constructed. There is an eastern alignment, which goes toward the campground, which is, you can build it, you know, you can have traffic on the existing structure while that one's being built. And there is a west half-width alternative, which would mean one-way control during construction. For each alignment,
there's also three rehab alternatives, one that rehabs the existing structure and also upgrades the rail. There's one that rehabs and widens the existing structure and upgrades the rail. And there's also an alternative that rehabs the existing bridge for a pedestrian bridge for use with a new structure.
Yeah.
So those will be done in combination and compared to the other alternatives that Tom just mentioned.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
And for each alignment alternative, there are the western alternatives can be box girder or arch. The eastern alternative is necessarily a box girder because you can't build an arch on a curve.
There is no preferred alternative right now. We are still conducting preliminary environmental studies. We still have to do a life cycle cost analysis. We will take a look at combinations of the rehab alternatives as well as the replacement alternatives. As you probably know, there's a significant amount of maintenance cost for the existing structure, which is just not sustainable. At some point, there will be that tipping point that really moves in favor of a replacement structure.
Eric's going to talk about the Salmon Creek Bridge alternatives. These are what we're studying in this environmental document we're talking about.
Okay. For Salmon Creek, there are four alignments. And kind of similar but to Albion, but that there's on each side, so there's east and west, and there's a alignment that stands alone. It would be built next to the existing bridge, you know, freestanding. Then there'd be a similar alternative to do the same thing on the east side. And then there's two alternatives that are closer and that would need to be built by half-width construction, and which would get you closer to the existing alignment. And you would build a piece of it, put the traffic on that, then tear down the old bridge, then build the other half of the bridge. So there's one of those on each side. So that's, it's pretty simple as far as, you know, what they, symmetry of it. Then there are three bridge types. There's a box girder, which...
It's actually over on this side.
Yeah, which is kind of more like Noyo, okay? And then we've got a spandrel arch, which looks similar to what is the Albion, and then there's what they call a modern arch, which is kind of a combination of the two. It's an arch, but it doesn't have as many of the vertical members. It's more open and more. So those are the, and then, I should add, on the two half-width bridges that are closer to the existing, you can't build the spandrel arch. So that with those two would only have the modern arch and the box girder. So that's the alternatives.
And there's also, as you probably can imagine, a significant amount of maintenance costs associated with the Salmon Creek Bridge, and those maintenance costs are not sustainable. At some point in our life cycle cost analysis, we'll see where that replacement alternative really needs to be built. So again, yes ma'am.
Well, when you say they'll have to be replaced sometime, even with repairing, how long does that mean? 5 years, 25?
We are still doing our preliminary studies. If you would like more information, I've brought a deputy directive that actually describes the use of the life cycle cost analysis and how we look at alternatives that are currently under study with the rehab alternative that we currently are looking at. But again, when we compare the cost of maintenance for the existing structure compared to the cost of a new bridge, at some point you will see where it's no longer sustainable to keep the existing bridge in place and continue to pay increased maintenance costs, because the cost to maintain that bridge will increase over time. As you probably noticed, we did just complete a project to basically repair and rehabilitate the bridge. But that is going to be a regular project, and you're going to be inconvenienced probably every couple of years.
All along. There's been Albion Bridge maintenance for a long time.
Exactly my point. And there's very little maintenance on a concrete structure. Okay? So
I do think maybe this is time to start questions, and I just want to preface this by saying there's a lot of studies to be done, and maybe we'll have different people here who are more expert in those studies answer questions.
Yes, I will. I did want to take opportunity to introduce our consultants, ICF. Yes, Linda.
I just want to know what community
impacts assessment means.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. Yeah. So why don't we introduce
the ICF?
Group? Yeah, so let's start with introducing ICF and ask them to answer that question, and then we'll introduce everybody that's here from Caltrans also.
Okay.
And see where your questions go, if that's a good plan.
So I'll introduce Christy Corzine, who is the project manager for ICF. She's right here. Christy, would you like to introduce your staff?
Sure. I'm actually the contract manager, and Adam Wagshall is our internal project manager. Adam Wagshall is our internal project manager, and he's based out of Arcata. I'm based out of our Reading office. Shihira Ashkar is our CEQA expert. She's based out of our Sacramento office. And Lindsay Christensen is our community impact assessment expert. And we have Stephanie Lister here also, who's our coastal resources and public outreach specialist. And Amy Dewar Smith, who is helping with the cumulative impacts and some of the permitting.
Can we ask one of you to answer?
So we'll get both the subject matter experts on community and cumulative impact assessment to maybe step forward over here, and then we can probably have a better opportunity to address the crowd.
Yeah, you could be close to them so they could hear.
Could you point to the structures and talk if it pertains?
Well, we're going to talk about the community impact assessment first, so we would like to provide just an overview on the community, what is involved in a community impact assessment.
Sure, so a community impact assessment is an environmental document that it describes the existing setting of the community. And there's a fact sheet up here. It's really basic, so it's a quick just overview, so you should all pick this up. So we just help just comply with various environmental laws, and there are different sections that go through just the land use and growth and public resources and emergency services and all different kinds of topics that are in the community. And then it will go through the different alternatives and basically just explain what the differences are. So it doesn't really take a stand either way. It just presents what is here and how each alternative will affect different community resources.
So can you explain how the different bridges will affect different community resources?
That's what the study will be about. So we haven't started yet, but when we do, it'll have various chapters covering all different kinds of topics. It'll talk about transportation and land use and schools, police and fire service, anything from school bus routes, stuff like that. So that's the purpose of the study, and then that'll be available for you to
read. What about going through somebody's house?
Acquisitions and displacements and all of that kind of information will be in there, yes.
We live just west of it. It's always west. It'll be going basically through our house.
On our web, everything.
Which bridge is that?
Either connecting the two bridges, whatever. If you move it west, it's going to.
Right. Well, right now, if any of you had an opportunity to review the value analysis study that is posted on the Caltrans project website for both Salmon Creek and for Albion, there is a value analysis study posted on both pages, and that value analysis study does select what is called the technically preferred alternative. And currently, that is the alternative that was selected in the VA study only. It doesn't really identify the preferred alternative, which is the purpose of the environmental document. But right now, the technically preferred alternative, that alternative which has the least environmental impact and the greatest benefit, is to the east for Salmon Creek, to the west for Albion.
Well, doesn't that mean the road is then going from east to south?
Well, on Salmon Creek, the road would be shifted east.
Okay.
And then it would actually come back into the existing alignment and then move to the west on Albion. That's as far as the technically preferred alternative. Again, no alternative has been selected. That's the purpose of the preliminary design environmental studies. And once we get to the point where we circulate the draft environmental document and we look at all the temporary and permanent impacts, then we get to a point where we select the preferred alternative for the final environmental document.
How far east of
the bridge? Well, Eric,
how far east on Salmon?
We try to get it as close as possible to the original footprint, and you probably need about 5 feet separation between the two structures to get your forms in there to construct it. So
we
it'll start there,
traffic.
And it'll be built totally to the east or in
totally
half width.
The east of the existing bridge.
east of the existing bridge, or in half width, you'd build half of it to get one single lane and tear down the existing and build the other half of the bridge so that so it would be close to the existing line.
Well, and the question was on our, basically, how wide would the new structure be? And based on our current design standards, we're looking at 12-foot lanes, 8-foot shoulders, and a 6-foot separated pedestrian walkway on the west side for the Salmon Creek Bridge. For the Albion River Bridge, for the replacement alternatives, we would be looking ideally at 12-foot lanes, 8-foot shoulders, and 2 6-foot separated pedestrian walkways, because we recognize that Albion has both the north and the south village on the east side of the highway, but the Coastal Commission recognizes the Coastal Trail on the west side of the highway, and they would prefer to see the separated pedestrian walkway on the west side. So we are looking at ultimately 2 6-foot separated pedestrian walkways, 12-foot lanes, 8-foot shoulders for Albion, 12-foot lanes, 8-foot shoulders with a 6-foot separated pedestrian walkway on the west side for Salmon Creek.
What about bike lanes?
52
feet. Yeah. If I could, just to give perspective.
And there is a cross section, there's a drawing of a cross section.
You had a question on the bike lane.
Let's just let Adam step in. I think it will be relevant.
If I could interject just briefly to give perspective about where we're at in the process, is we're just starting to develop the environmental documents. So these different studies that Frank pointed to, those are studies we're going to just start now. Community impact assessment, biological, cultural resource, and so forth. So we're happy, we want that input now, but also after we develop draft documents, and there'll be an EIR for Albion, and an initial study for Salmon Creek, those will go to public review. And so then you can provide comments on, did we do a good job? What did we miss? What are your thoughts about what the preferred, what the alternative should be? So right now, again, we're just starting those studies, and there'll be, you know, future opportunity to give input once we get our head a little better around what the environmental effects are and what the preferred alternative might be.
Was to leave the old bridge as a for pedestrian cultural use.
That's one of the alternatives.
What happened to that notion? I don't see any pictures of two bridges.
It is one of the, there's no picture of it, but it is one of the alternatives.
We don't have a picture of it as the alternative, but that will be studied for the Albion River Bridge. Yeah.
All right, but I did hear that as one of the alternatives as you were listing six.
I did mention that as one of the alternatives.
Describe that.
I described the rehab alternative for the existing structure. And we do have plans over here that show what the rehab alternative would look like.
Okay, so we are studying that. We have about 5 minutes for questions.
Okay.
Your rehab alternatives always include a new bridge?
No.
Just one of them, is two bridges.
The rehab alternative has really three rehab alternatives. One is just to rehab the current bridge and upgrade the rail, because the current rail is not the safety standards. The second alternative is to rehab the existing structure, widen the structure to 8-foot shoulders, and upgrade the rail. The third alternative is to rehab the existing structure for pedestrian use only, in conjunction with the replacement structure.
Okay, and I want to make sure everybody has an opportunity for a group question, so I'm going to ask new questions, and I promise we will stay and clarify anything that's confusing at the end, all right? I want to commit to that, but let's ask everybody.
Place. On which side, the west or the east, would the new structure be built?
We have alternatives that would study both.
Yeah, the west alternative and the east alternative are the only ones that would include the rehab of the existing structure for pedestrian use. The on-alignment alternative obviously would require removal of the existing structure.
That's one reason we have so many. But you have a question?
Designated historic structure?
Right, and we how expect that, that it will be designated. I am not an expert in this, so I'm going to pass it on to someone more expert. I can answer this if anyone feels unqualified, but yeah, we expect that to happen.
Okay, well, the question was, what happens if the Albion River Bridge is designated or listed on the National Registry of Historic Places
as a historic structure, and it is.
I can answer that, but maybe Christy. Yeah. Well, basically, we would have to mitigate for its loss, and
or any impacts to it.
Right, and that is something that we have two individuals here from our landscape architecture squad who are who have a list of questions that you may want to look at what your interest would be.
Some questions specifically about that we're asking people to fill out. It's at the table over there. I'd love to pass it around just so people can see it, but yeah, this is something we would really like your feedback on.
So I can add a little more clarification to that. So right now, the bridge has already been designated as eligible for listing on the National Register of Historic Places. And so in the environmental process, properties that have been determined to be eligible for listing, even if they are not officially gone through the end of the process to get listed, are treated as though they are listed on the National Register. So for purposes of our environmental document and the technical studies supporting that, it won't make any difference whether the bridge actually gets listed, because we're already treating it in the analysis as if it is.
And a listing bridge. What can you possibly do to mitigate that deliberate situation?
Yeah, that's a good question. There are a lot of recommended and acceptable types of mitigation that the State Historic Preservation Office approves for demolishing or removal of historic structures, including bridges. And oftentimes those include some sort of archival documentation of the existing structure, or some video or program that is made that talks about the history and the architecture of it. And sometimes there are interpretive centers. One of the ideas that Caltrans has is to have an interpretive area as part of the Albion Bridge that would have both natural and cultural history interpretation. And that's one of the things that the questionnaire
gives you opportunity to
is asking
put your
what,
ideas
what would be your ideas for mitigation.
And if you have more questions on that after this presentation, you're certainly to go over and talk to Flora Barbash over here with her hand up, and she can definitely answer a lot of your questions.
Jim, do you have a question?
Yeah, I've got a couple. Okay. With respect to the proposed replacements of the Albion River Bridge, if you're not good at adding up 12 foot lines plus 6 foot shoulders, that adds up to a total of 54 feet, correct? 54 feet width?
Correct.
For purposes of comparison, the current Albion River Bridge is 26 feet wide, so this is more than twice as wide. And I have a document here that was sent to Caltrans, to Adele Pomerant from the Coastal Commission from 2015, where they specifically talk about the width of the proposed bridge, the proposed replacement of 54 feet, and they say, quote, that it would conflict with Coastal Act and Mendocino County local coastal plan policies intended to make the rural portions of Route 1 as a scenic byway. And my question is, and they further state that in that area, a maximum roadway width of 32 feet is what's recommended. My question is, given that Caltrans received this document in 2015, why does the current design still stipulate it?
Because the Mendocino County Code doesn't specifically address structures. As you just read there, that only addresses a roadway. In the past, the county and the Coastal Commission have approved for those bridges that are north, like 10 Mile River Bridge, and south, like Greenwood Creek, 6 foot shoulders. Those two bridges have an annual, the ADT is below 2,000, whereas at Albion it's above 3,200. So based on our own design standards, we would be seeking to get 8 foot shoulders. Now, we are preparing a presentation for the Coastal Commission Roads Edge Committee to make a pitch for 8 foot shoulders. We believe that our standards serve safety in this case, and we can certainly get Eric and Tom and Mark to speak to that. But we feel that our design standards for 12-foot lanes and 8-foot shoulders are valid, and we intend to go to the Coastal Commission and make that argument. Now, we recognize that the coastal plan with Mendocino County for roadway is 32 feet, but that addresses specifically roadway, not structures.
Does it's interesting answer? That a bridge is not a roadway.
It's a structure.
It's a fine
and
point.
And yet it's got a road on it.
But at this, I think what's important to know is what the commission has approved, and we are in ongoing dialogues with them, and this is something that may be changed because of the studies and the impacts that we find. For instance, will there be two walkways on the Albion River Bridge, or will the Coastal Commission and the community say, we only need one? The bridge is too wide with two, it's not necessary. It's possible that that kind
of
comment
Jim, let me just give you an example. Okay, look at the 10 Mile River Bridge. You've got 12-foot lanes, 6-foot shoulders, low ADT, and a 6-foot separated pedestrian walkway on the west side.
And all of those are narrower than what Caltrans had originally proposed.
They're 2 feet narrower on the shoulders, because before we had gone in for 8-foot shoulders, but we went in and based on the permit that we could get from the Coastal Commission, we downgraded that to 6-foot shoulders. But the ADT at that section of Highway 1 is much lower. It's much higher in Albion and in Salmon Creek area.
ADT is the density of traffic, the number of cars.
The number of cars,
number
exactly.
Of vehicles.
Yeah, but again, 12-foot lane, 6-foot shoulders.
And then the 6-foot pedestrian
walkway. You're talking
walkway.
36 plus the 6-foot separated walkway, 42 feet. You say 32 feet. So that's, again, the county recognizes that addresses only roadway, 32-foot roadway. That's why we look at 12-foot lanes and 4-foot shoulders for the regular highway, which comes to 32, of course, but that doesn't specifically address structures.
But can Heinz, do you have a comment or question?
I want
to let everyone have an opportunity here.
I'd like to talk to this specific.
Okay, afterwards, you're welcome to.
We have lots of people with questions, Beth. And I think this gentleman over here had a question. Jim?
The other question that I had deals with the fact that, of course, the bridges are what is getting most people's attention, but another big part of the project involves the significant widening of Highway 1 from Navarro Ridge Road to Albion Ridge Road. And from the final value analysis from 2013, one aspect of that calls for a retaining wall, a concrete retaining wall 12 feet high and 170 feet long, that I think is around the Pacific Reefs area.
Right,
and that's my question is, are you aware of any other retaining walls of that size and scope in an area that is designated as highly scenic?
Eric, I don't believe that.
Most of this is in the Albion area. The proposed retaining wall over there, I don't think, we found that it's not necessary any longer. And there's not really gonna be a lot of widening in the roadway between the two bridges. We want to get the 32 feet that you described, the two 12-foot lanes and 4-foot shoulders, and that pretty much exists out there. There's a small area of widening, and we've determined we can wiggle around.
Which retaining wall are you talking about?
It doesn't really. Pardon?
He's looking at the PSR.
Retaining wall between milepost 42.5 to 43.54.
Is that between, that's between Albion and Salmon Creek, right?
I think it's just south of Salmon Creek.
Yeah, they were looking at a...
Between the two, so you
at one point, they were looking at a wall down in this section south of Salmon Creek, but we are no longer looking at that.
There is
a possibility for a wall on the east side in order to decrease some of the right-of-way impacts. And we're still looking at different scenarios for making it a smaller or shorter wall.
Are there documents online that have the current plans? Because it's kind of hard for the community.
For that, no. We're still looking at that. We haven't gotten the final.
It's still being refined. So when the draft document comes out, there'll be opportunity to comment.
Yeah, we're still developing an alternative there, as far as just that wall.
Thank you.
Lyons?
Frank, on roadway widths and bridge widths, since it's an issue, and since you're going to comply with the Coastal Commission's decision, isn't it appropriate immediately to go to them and configure the widths throughout the project? Estimates over again and other things.
Right, and that's why we have a presentation to the Roads Edge Committee this June to discuss with them the design standards that Caltrans has where 8-foot shoulders would be a requirement.
I understand that.
But at the same time, if the Coastal Commission says to us, look, you're not going to get a permit for anything other than 6-foot shoulders, well, that to us is enough to go back to management and basically
discuss.
Talk about what our options are here for 12-foot lanes and 6-foot shoulders rather than the 8-foot shoulders, which is what our design manual dictates.
My only point is, that's an issue today. It ought to be decided tomorrow.
I agree.
Okay.
My question has to do with Caltrans and shoulders. The new Willits bypass, which most of it is a structure like an aqueduct.
1 mile of it is, yes, it's a mile.
Has, but there are visually no shoulders on that aqueduct. It's like the two lanes and that's it.
A viaduct?
Viaduct, yes,
but we know what you're talking about. Okay, so you know one reason that is, and I am not an expert on the design of that, but I worked on that project for a long time. That's only half the Willits bypass that you're driving on. We built half of it. We didn't have enough money to build all of it. We didn't have enough support to build all of it. So when we build the other half, there'll be shoulders with it.
Well, we're not here to talk about Beth. We're not here to talk about Willits anyway. So let's.
You said that Caltrans requires. They did not require a finished bypass in Willits to have any shoulder at all.
Yes. I can answer that because
Thank
I
you,
work
Phil.
So much with it.
Thank you,
Mrs. Phil Frisbee. Those are 8-foot shoulders. I've walked out on it, and they are.
They're actual full 8-foot shoulders.
They are. We actually widened the viaduct because we were built because when we re-engineered it to be two phases, we built basically the southbound lanes, and the shoulders were widened. So both sides
are full 8-foot
shoulders. I've walked out there.
When you're driving fast, I give it, but. Shoulders are so important for safety. They really are, and that's one reason Caltrans supports them so much. It's not only that bicyclists are out there, or maintenance workers are out there, or rainwater is out there that you don't want to drive through. We will have to work closely with the Coastal Commission. We're not building this project without a permit from them. But shoulders are really important for everybody.
Okay, but I know there's more questions. Here, sir.
The old bridge, if it does become a historical landmark, who pays for it?
We don't have a solution to that right now.
Well, as far as if it were to be used as a pedestrian structure?
We do know it'll be expensive. We do, yes. We're studying that. And
Caltrans is not willing.
Yeah, well, that's a good question. So we will be talking about the cost that we have determined to maintain it currently and turn it into either an annual or biannual cost that we'll disclose in the environmental document.
It's still a public right-of-way of sorts. Even if it's pedestrian, it's still going to have to meet all the state safety standards, correct?
Yeah, it's not free. You're
right. What's happened in the past in similar situations?
Sometimes counties have taken them over, cities and counties. The city of Reading took over an older bridge that's part of their river trail.
So it has to come out of the county.
Sometimes nonprofits can do it. Yeah.
We have a question right here.
Do you have a handout here where you show the public the sequence of events from the scoping session through the draft EIR to the EIR? So the scoping session you consider happened in Albion, and you got written comments and verbal comments. Are these on your webpage?
The public scoping?
They are not, to my knowledge, all
not.
Of them.
They should be on your webpage so everybody can access this. Also, you're not showing here how many days the public has to respond once you do a hearing or once you say that draft EIR starts. So we would like to know when those timelines are.
Well, right now, built in the schedule, we have 6 months from the draft environmental document to the final environmental document. Liza, maybe you'd like to respond to that?
Yeah, really quick. Yeah. So we kept this generic, so it could be used for both bridges, both Salmon and Albion. So because there are two different document types for both projects. So the Salmon document will be circulated for 30 days for public comment. And for Albion, it'll be 45 days because we're doing an EIR on that project.
Why aren't you doing an EIR on the Salmon?
Because of the project impacts will be less than they will be for Albion.
So are you doing a mitigated negative declaration?
Yes,
for
we are.
Salmon?
Yep.
And so if the public is not happy with that, we get to appeal?
You certainly can put in your comments, and those will be reviewed during the period once the circulation is complete.
When is the earliest you're going to start the draft EIR or the MND?
So I believe we're circulating Salmon. We're hoping February of 2018. And for Albion, we're hoping August of 2018. And so everyone who's previously commented before, we will notify them once those documents are out. And they'll be put on the project webpage also.
Rationale for putting it on the east side of the old bridge?
I'm sorry?
What is the rationale for putting a new bridge on the east side of the old bridge?
Are you talking about Albion?
So why are we studying an eastern alignment for Albion? One rationale is the Coastal Commission requires a full range of alternatives. We understand it's not as desirable because of the impacts to the community, and that's what Tom talked about. But we are going to study it so we can disclose this to the whole community and public to comment on it.
If we
don't
didn't
expect
study it, then we would be asked why we didn't
become
study it.
The preferred. But yeah, it's quite possible the Coastal Commission
we're
would
required
ask us
to
study
to
that.
Evaluate all practical alternatives, which the eastern alignment would be. John, you got a question?
Will your planning efforts include maximizing the $1 million investment you just made in Albion and lengthening your timeline?
That would be considered as part of the life cycle cost analysis, and we've already had the structures maintenance investigation rerun the numbers for the structural integrity of the bridge. So yes, that will be included as part of the life cycle cost analysis moving forward.
Yeah. Sir? You talked a couple of times about a break-even point where maintaining the bridge would no longer be cost effective. So I assume you know that date, right? How many years out? And
we're studying that because right now we're just getting the numbers back from the recent project that was completed for Albion, and we'll take a look at those numbers and we'll project forward based on what we see the anticipated increase in maintenance costs for the existing structure, and we'll compare that to the cost to replace and what the maintenance costs are for a new structure.
That was my question, is how do you evaluate the tipping point? What is the definition of what the tipping point is?
Well, you look at the existing bridge, how much longer does it really have? 20 years? And if you put in $2 million every year, year and a half, 2 years, and a new bridge costs $24 million and is going to last 75 to 100 years, then you have to look at where the tipping point is. Even if you spend a lot of money up front on a replacement structure, your maintenance costs are going to be near zero. Whereas if you continue to put money into the existing structure, does that really make sense to keep pouring in money into a structure that's only got 20 years life left? Or do you build a new structure, put money up front now, that's going to have less maintenance costs moving forward?
Now that 20-year figure is a hypothetical that you don't...
Well, that's a hypothetical, but if you look at the splits, checks, and cracks in the existing timbers, the amount of money that you have to spend on replacing the bolts, we don't even know what the condition of the internal shearing connectors are. There's certainly some section loss, but without completely dismantling the bridge, you know, how would you be able to tell how much section loss each one of the shearing connectors has had?
But the point is 20 years is a hypothetical figure that you're throwing
exactly,
in the
that's
interest
a,
of math.
Yeah, but you have to start somewhere. You look at the life of the timber, and we haven't even talked about the leaching of arsenic and chromium from the existing structure and the lead contamination from the Salmon Creek Bridge. So those are also issues that we'll have to evaluate, because that existing structure at Albion continues to leach arsenic and chromium into the environment.
Which actually brings up a question. If the Albion Bridge is dismantled, what happens to the materials? I know that DTSC has talked about that in the past.
Yeah, let's
ask. We'll bring Steve Werner up here. He's our expert, and he can answer some of those questions.
What happens to it?
What's the question?
Question is, what happens to the timbers after the bridge is decommissioned?
On the Albion River Bridge, if we were to dismantle it?
It'd be good to landfill. It'd go to a lined landfill. And because they're treated wood, they're considered hazardous waste, but DTSC allows treated wood to go to a lined landfill, class 3 landfill.
Is there any estimate as to how many truckloads of that hazardous waste would be on the roads, on our roads, as it was trucked out?
I don't have those numbers.
I'll tell you what the number, the cost to actually decommission that bridge and move it to the landfill is $1.2 million right now. $1.2
million. Yeah. Do you think you could do it for that? Yeah, that sounds like a bargain, doesn't it? Well,
John, I would show you photos that I brought that actually have sections of those beams that have rotted spaces, 3-4 inches wide, 8 inches deep, that we've now cleaned out and we filled with epoxy resin. We have large splits and checks going up some of the timbers, and exactly, but then what happens, John, it requires maintenance, doesn't it? It requires costly maintenance, and the cost of maintenance continues to climb. So you have to look at where is the value to the taxpayers in the long run. There is a tipping point where you can continue to pour money into a bridge for maintenance with a limited lifespan, or build the replacement structure, even though you have an initial investment that's high, in the long run for a structure that's going to last 75 to 100 years or more, you're not going to have the maintenance costs that you do with the current structure.
75 years ago, the state spent $300,000 to build that bridge, and they've been using it ever since.
And
don't want to stop using it before
that's true.
Its life
but at
is
the time
done.
That they built it, the intention was that bridge was going to be in for 15 to 20 years because it was built with the idea that it would be replaced with a concrete structure. The original bridge that was planned for that crossing was concrete. If not for the war, it never would have been built. And it was only given a certain limited lifespan, and a replacement structure of concrete was always planned.
That limited lifespan was based on something they didn't really know. That was a brand new process at preserving wood like that. And it's lasted an extra 50 years beyond their 20, and it's still in perfect shape. It's checked, all beams checked. But that wood is, you go up underneath that bridge and start drilling holes in that thing, it's perfect. Those are 6x20 beams, 17 across, 1,000 feet long. That's a fantastic amount of wood. It's a very valuable asset. And to haul it to a toxic dump is a horrible insult to the effort that was made 75 years ago by the people that put that bridge together. And the community has been using it ever since, and now it's going to be a historic asset, which I think speaks well of Caltrans' wonderful maintenance situation. You've taken great care of that, and this National Register listing is going to be a feather in your cap.
Well, John, would you agree it reaches a point where the maintenance costs will actually really outweigh the benefit of replacement structure? Because we're also talking about a structure that has 1 foot shoulder.
Yeah.
Doesn't provide any
bicyclists. We know 300 to 500 bicyclists ride across that every summer.
What's been the maintenance cost over annually for the last 10 years?
Well, that has increased, but I will tell you this last contract was for approximately $2 million. Okay, and that just includes the capital cost, not the support cost. For Caltrans to develop the plans and to actually oversee the repairs that were made.
What are you doing? You're putting those things, those sliders around. What else are you doing?
Well, we replaced over 700 bolts. We repaired the spalling on the concrete towers. We also repaired the splits, checks, and the rotted sections on the beams. And
we replaced
also
the asphalt?
We also
replace the bolts with something that you don't have to replace again for 100 years.
There's no such product that
we're going to allow questions, and if we want to have a one-on-one type of dialogue, I think we can do it separately.
But ask your question again. What is it? Your question was, what is the accident profile on that bridge? One truck, which would have gone over no matter what the design of the bridge was. One truck. There are not deaths and accidents on that bridge because there are no shoulders and people tend to slow down.
It is good that people slow
down.
Does
anybody here walk across that bridge right now?
I used to walk across that bridge, not now.
Do you walk across
that
bridge?
You
walk across that bridge? You feel safe walking across that bridge?
I feel like the way it's set makes me be super, super careful and take my responsibility into my own hands. And I think, I'm sure you've read the book Traffic. That's one of the clear things they say, that in a marketplace where there's people on bicycles and with carts, and it's clear that it's a human place, everyone slows down and it becomes safer in that way. And yeah, I walk across the bridge and I'm very careful and alert, and I'll sometimes go from side to side and you know, wave my arms, and I feel safe doing that.
What is the safety record on that bridge?
Right.
There's been one accident in 75 years.
Have you ever walked across that bridge, John?
No, I haven't.
I lived right underneath it.
I haven't either. I've been there 7 years.
If you had a separate pedestrian walkway, an opportunity to actually ride your bike across that bridge, wouldn't you like to?
Yeah, wouldn't.
Okay.
People in the community feel more comfortable.
Ride across that bridge. I walk across that bridge. You know, it's a special space, and people, drivers, act in, with special reactions to being there.
You know, thank you for letting us know.
Communities also make a choice between, is this a bridge I want to walk across, or is this a bridge that has historical and cultural significance to the community? I mean, it costs a lot to maintain the pyramids, but we do that as a society because they provide value, they provide cultural value, they provide tourism value. So,
okay.
I think Caltrans needs to recognize those intangibles.
The Albion River Bridge aren't the pyramids. It isn't a natural system that
but,
that is punished by traffic that crosses
daily,
every
Golden Gate Bridge.
Time.
I think, the can
I
just
has say, high maintenance.
Let's have some of these
here.
Dialogue. We're going to bring this to a conclusion and have individual dialogues, because I think these kinds of conversations are more productive that way. I will let you have a question. I just want to say one thing, that yes, you know, this is a transportation system, so we need to keep that scope and what our solutions are. But let's have you be the last question. We're going to break it into individual dialogue and exchange.
Okay, does Caltrans have the money to replace our bridges?
It is programmed right now, and we better get on with it because prices are going up.
I was
going
to say, I keep
right
hearing you guys don't have the
contingency
money.
Contingency project, so that means that it does not have money actually set aside for the construction of the bridge unless other projects are delayed or more money becomes available. There are 8 bridges on the Mendocino coast that need repair, widening, rail upgrades, or replacing. We have to look at the entire program, and that is what we have to consider based on the amount of money that is available for that program.
Okay. So I'd like to, you know, conclude our group discussion and start our individual discussions where we can have exchange and share opinions and have an opportunity for everyone to.
Thank you for doing this.
Thank you.
You didn't tell us
tonight.
When the next meeting is going
we have,
to
we
be.
Have, we have one more question.
Yeah, we have one more question.
Let's conclude with your question.
I've been here quietly. You said that it's a contingency budget. What's the difference between a contingency budget and being an allocated budget, other than the money? What's the process to go from contingency to allocation, and how long does that take?
It's a contingency project. There's only so much money available in a particular fiscal year for a certain number of projects. If some projects are actually completed, studies are done, and we are ready to go with the project, then that will go to vote to the CTC, the California Transportation Commission. If projects are delayed and that leaves a hole in the program, then other projects have an opportunity to take advantage of that hole and use those funds.
Funding is competitive. You know, statewide.
Bill, I'll tell you what. You tell us when you want us to come to
your neck of the woods. We'll go down to your school.
We'll come see you and we'll answer
on Albion
more questions.
Ridge Road.
How's
we'll
that?
Come visit again.
Okay.
Okay. You have a chance to ask a question.
You said this.
So the related to this funding, for instance, the Big Sur Bridge is out.
Oh, yes, that's storm
sure
damage.
That you are aware of that, and so things like that take the money as opposed to.
There's a statewide bridge program, and there's a statewide program manager and program advisor that looks at all of the bridge projects statewide and the available funding for those bridge projects. As Lana mentioned, all these projects compete for that funding. If some projects are delayed and funding becomes available, depending on which project has the most merit as far as the program manager and the program advisor are concerned, that project moves in to fill that hole.
But just to conclude, transportation funding is complex, so it's not simple, and that bridge down into Big Sur will need to be fixed more immediately, so that funding will come in from the feds, but it's a complex scenario. Okay, this is truly our last question, okay?
This is I live under the bridge, I get a little choice.
Okay, you get the last question.
Contingency budget, I want to go back to that real quick for another clarification. How can it be a contingency project at this time? Ready to take money that's delayed from another project when there hasn't even been an EIS started or an EIR?
Because this project isn't programmed until fiscal year 21-22. So that's when that funding would be sought.
Okay. We fund parts of the studies and then construction.
Very good.
Okay, so I invite you all to come down and talk to our Caltrans folks and our ICF representatives about the project.